A little over a year ago, somebody asked me if it's possible to diagnose wristwatches using a contact mic. And at that time, I made a video showing how to record a wristwatch with a contact mic and how to remove background noise. But it turns out that that whole video was predicated on my own misunderstanding. I thought that you would diagnose a wristwatch by listening to the ticks. I also made that video before Metal Marshmallow Pro existed. And Metal Marshmallow Pro has a noise floor that's so much lower that reducing background noise isn't as relevant. Additionally, this microphone is so sensitive that it can easily hear the quartz oscillator in the wristwatch. And that turns out to be a far more accurate way of measuring the timing of the watch. And so today, I want to show you how to do that. So to start with, I have my microphone. I'm going to put a little poster putty on it, and I'm going to plug that into my audio interface. And then on my computer, I'm going to go into my audio settings. And the quartz oscillator in wristwatches oscillates at 32,678 hertz. And so I'm going to need a sample rate that's at least twice that. So this regular 44.1 kilohertz sample rate isn't going to work for this. And I've been using 96 kilohertz, and that seems to work quite well. And then I'm going to go to my website, and I have a new section on my website called Widgets, and I'll talk more about this in an upcoming video. But for now, I'm just going to go to the wristwatch diagnostics, and I'm using Chrome for this. Chrome is the only browser that I've tested that works. Every other browser that I've tested filters out high frequency sounds, and Chrome is the only one that doesn't. And some browsers also seem like they struggle with these high sample rates. And the first watch that I'm going to test is actually this Secure ID chip. And it's basically just a glorified digital watch, and it has one of these quartz oscillators in it. And I opened it up previously because I was trying to reverse engineer it. And it's funny because I carried this around with me every day for 3 years. I never realized that it makes sound because it sounds completely quiet. But as soon as I stick it to my contact mic, you can see that the VU meter goes up by a couple of clicks. And that's because, of course, this thing is making sound. Its frequency is just so high that you can't hear it. Anyway, so I'm going to move this slider all the way to the right, and I'll explain that more in a minute. And then I'm going to press this sample button, and it's going to take about 25 seconds to collect enough data, and I'll fast forward through that. And then at the end, you get this plot, and lo and behold, it has this huge peak, right? Almost exactly at 32,678 hertz. And if I look at the bottom of this page, it's telling me that this clock runs slow by about 0.9 seconds per day. And that's quite good, but that makes sense because this device needs to stay synchronized with a server, and so they almost certainly deliberately used a very high accuracy oscillator. Now I know that some of you are looking at this plot and thinking that this couldn't be very high resolution because the peak is here, and then the next samples to the left and right of that are here. And these samples differ by about 3 hertz. And in terms of the wristwatch's timing error, that gives this a resolution of only about 8 seconds per day. And that's not very good. I would think that you would want to know at least within, you know, 1 second per day what the watch's error is. And so what I do is I actually draw a parabola through these 3 points, and then it's the apex of that parabola that tells you with very high resolution exactly what the frequency of that oscillator is. And that's how I ended up with this value of about negative 0.9 seconds per day. And then just to get some idea of the accuracy of this measurement, I'm just going to repeat the measurement again. And I'll fast forward through it, and then here's the plot of that, and you can see that it's almost identical to the plot before. And if I look at the bottom, it's still telling me that this clock has an error of about negative 0.9 seconds per day. So it seems like the accuracy of this measurement is probably well within 0.1 seconds per day. So it's very accurate. So now I'm going to get rid of this thing, and I've got this wristwatch that I'm going to put on there. And this is what that sounds like. But anyway, as I said, I'm not interested in the ticking sound of the wristwatch. I'm interested in the sound of the oscillator. And so again, I'm gonna press my sample button, and 24 seconds later, this is the plot that I get. And you can see the peak here is much smaller than with the other watch, but it's big enough. And if I look at the bottom, it's telling me that this watch runs fast by about 10.5 seconds per day. And that's fairly typical for a cheap wristwatch like this. And again, I'll repeat this measurement just to check on the accuracy. And that's telling me more like 10.7 seconds per day. And so clearly when the peak is smaller, the measurement isn't going to be as accurate. But still, this measurement seems to have an accuracy of well within 1 second per day. So it's quite accurate. Okay, so now I want to explain the function of this slider. So if I move this all the way to the left, then this software is just going to grab about 1/3 of a second of sound and plot that. And this is what it looks like. And I guess technically there still is a peak there. It's just that it's absolutely buried in the noise. And if I look down at the bottom, the number here is clearly way off. This software just can't find the peak. And so if I move the slider up to say 2, now the software is going to repeat that measurement twice and plot the average. Of course, it'll take twice as long, but that's still less than a second. But so even if I just put this at 10 and run it, that's only going to take about 4 seconds. And that peak looks okay. And in fact, if I scroll down, this is still reporting an error of something like 10.9 seconds. So that agrees pretty well with the values I was getting before. It's just that this plot has more noise in it going off to the sides out here, especially when you compare it back to that original measurement that I made with 100 samples. Here there's almost no noise at all going out to the sides, and that extra little bit of noise just interferes with your ability to very precisely fit a parabola to those 3 points. And so that's why you end up with a little bit less accuracy. But this is really only an issue when you have a weak signal like you do with this particular wristwatch. So if I go back to this other watch, I can turn this slider all the way down to 1 and grab just like 1/3 of a second worth of data. And this is what that looks like. Well, you can't see it very well because of the color. Sorry about that. Let me do this again. So this is what that looks like. And even with this tiny amount of data, this peak is still well above the noise. And if I scroll down to the bottom, I can see that it's still telling me that the error is about -0.9 seconds per day. So when you have a strong peak like this, you can still get a very accurate measurement with just a tiny amount of data. So yeah, anyway, that's that. So I should be clear that what this software really does is compares the clock in your watch to the clock in your computer. And of course, the clock in your computer is also not calibrated. So you have to take these measurements with a grain of salt. You certainly couldn't use this software for legal metrology, at least not without calibrating your computer's clock. Although as a side note, if you had some watches that you independently knew what the timing error was, then you could use those to get the calibration curve for your computer. But I'll leave that as an exercise to the reader. The other thing that I'll say is that it's a little bit difficult for me to really thoroughly test this software because this is a little bit outside of my area of expertise. And so if there are any of you who would actually use this software, who have any suggestions about how it could be improved or features that could be added or anything that could make it more useful, or if you have data that you could send my way that I could use to test it further, I would be happy to hear from you. So please do that. But anyway, I guess that's all I have to say about that for now. Remember to like and subscribe and all that kind of stuff. And I don't know if you find any of this useful or entertaining, maybe consider buying a microphone from me. That's my only source of income at the moment, so I would greatly appreciate if you did that. But anyway, I guess I'll see you next time. Bye!